is in bloom. The PIA transmissions will resume. I try to push, try to keep us all down, down, and hope that we will never see the truth around. Another promise, another scene, another a package like to keep us trapped in greed. All a green belts wrapped around our minds, an endless red tape to keep the truth confined.
Welcome to the discussion of monkey dust. We're going to talk about bath salts and plant food. You have no doubt seen in the press, heard on the internet, about bath salts. What are they? Well, these are cathinone analog stimulants. So cathinone is a natural occurring stimulant from the cot plant, which is what you see down in the corner of the screen there, which grows amongst other places in East Africa. And there are many, many synthetic variants of it. But the two big ones are MDPV, which was first synthesized in 1969 as part of pharmaceutical research to help with chronic fatigue and to promote weight loss. And it was found to be far too hallucinogenic, so it was never taken for FDA approval. As of 2004, it was rediscovered and released as a designer drug. Mefedrone was first synthesized in 1929 and then re-identified and really promoted in 2003 on a web page called The Hive, which is where underground chemists talk about what they've synthesized and how to synthesize things. And the effect is like that of the cathinone from cot or PCP or MDMA, ecstasy, or any of the other stimulants. Both of those drugs, mefedrone and MDPV, would be banned under the Federal Analog Act of 1970 if they were intended for human consumption. But since no one consumes bath salts or plant food, and now it's being marketed as cleaning powders that are labeled not for human consumption, they were legal to import in the U.S., and most of them are being synthesized in Southeast Asia, particularly in China, and shipped in barrels and drums and boxes through FedEx and UPS and showing up in the U.S. So they were legal to import in the U.S., despite the fact that they are analogous to cathinone, which is a banned substance. They've been in the U.S. probably as long as anywhere else, so the early 2003-2004 range, but they really made their first big impact in, first real appearance in 2008, and then the first big impact in 2010, and the media picked up on this in 2011. Now, the Bangor and Lewiston Auburn areas have been seeing this since 2010, and monkey dust is a street name in Bangor. It's not clear where monkey dust comes from, although I'm told by sources that some of the earliest bath salts sold had a packet with a purple monkey on it, and that gave it its name, at least locally. These are stimulant drugs, so basically they work like really, 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 really high-power antidepressants. The monoamine neurotransmitters like dopamine, serotonin, melatonin are all released, but so are epinephrine and norepinephrine, which gives you a lot of the effects that people don't want. Most people are shooting this up or smoking it. It can also be snorted, taken rectally, or just ingested orally. Why do people take it? Well, what they're hoping will happen is euphoria, some mild mental and sexual stimulation, an elevated mood, decreased hostility, and improved mental acuity. But unfortunately, there are both psychiatric and physiologic effects. There's tachycardia, hypertension, hyperthermia. Those are the people who are in agitated delirium where, in fact, they're no longer controlling their own metabolism. You can see skin flushing with palpitations, peripheral vasoconstriction or peripheral vasodilation, resulting in either flushing or cool extremities. They're dyspneic, they get headaches. And then the real issue that we've had to deal with is psychosis, hallucinations, paranoia, erratic behavior, agitation, and depression. And so generally I've divided these patients into three groups when I see them in the emergency department. There's the euphorics. We don't see a lot of those. Those are the people who are just high and don't really like the high, and that's why they're there or someone brought them in. They're the toxics. Those are who are have the agitated delirium, so they're no longer controlling their own metabolism. They're hyperthermic, and those people are going to die typically. They take incredible resuscitation to save them. And then the ones we're seeing most of are the psychotics, and those are the ones who may be aware of what's going on, but who are having hallucinations or who are very paranoid and who have completely inappropriate behaviors, sometimes very violent behaviors. We don't know how long it lasts when people take this. It really varies by the route. The onset is typically from 30 minutes to 2 hours, sometimes sooner if it's smoked. And it can last minutes to hours, but we're seeing relapses now up to 72 hours without redosing, where people are becoming psychotic again. And there's a case report from Louisiana of a patient who was psychotic, was intubated, sedated, kept in the intensive care unit, and after 12 days was brought out of sedation and was still psychotic. So how do you recognize these people? Well, typically you're going to get a call for odd behaviors. There'll be altered mental status with agitation, and they're going to be very activated. They're going to be moving around and have a lot of energy, as opposed to someone who is using a depressant like an opiate or a benzodiazepine. They may complain of their skin being on fire from the peripheral vasodilation. They'll may be hyperthermic. If they are, that's a very bad sign. It means they've lost control of their ability to control their temperature. And temperatures of 107, 110 have been seen. They'll be sweaty, potentially tachycardic. Their blood pressure might be up. And frankly, because these are really barely illegal, at least in Maine at this point, they're likely to tell you. When this was legal, people were more than happy to tell us that they were using bath salts. How do you treat them? Well, if they are euphoric, just transport them. If they're psychotic, keep yourself safe and consider some sedating medication if they become very agitated. If you're seeing agitated delirium with the hyperthermia, chemical restraint is the goal. You need to sedate these people. And so you need to start with physical restraint, and that's not going to be you, and it's not going to be you and your partner. That's enough people, including law enforcement, to effectively control these people. Otherwise, just stay in the area and keep an eye on them until they can be physically controlled. Law enforcement may choose to use conductive energy devices, tasers. And if they do that, coordinate with them, because these people have superhuman strength and they are insensate to pain when they get to this point. And so they get tased, but think about if you tripped onto a feather bed. You'd fall down, you'd get right back up. You wouldn't be hurt. And it's the same way with these people. They don't feel the discomfort. They're not conscious of it. So they go down and they get up immediately. So you need to coordinate that as soon as the person gets tased or physically restrained, you can get in there and chemically restrain them. And it's basically benzos, benzos, and benzos. We have seen patients receive up to 26 milligrams of Ativan, which translates roughly to 50 to 75 milligrams of Versed, and still be awake, talking, and agitated. Now, there are a lot of pitfalls in your treatment of these patients. Prolonged physical struggle can result in sudden cardiac arrest. They're already activated, and now you're releasing a lot more epinephrine and norepinephrine, and the heart's very sensitized to this. If you don't have enough restraint personnel, you and the patient is going to end up hurt. If you physically restrain them but don't chemically restrain them, they'll continue to struggle. There's the risk of cardiac arrest. There's the risk of self-injury. Once you've restrained them, keep them restrained, physical restraints and chemical restraints, until you turn them over to the emergency department. And don't forget the things, the medical issues that look like this. Hypoglycemic patients can look like this before they become unresponsive. People with closed head injuries. And who hasn't been swatted by the little old lady who's septic from her urinary tract infection? So you've got to consider all these other things as well. Okay, that's everything on bath salts for now. Be safe with this. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me. Thank you.